to give him the whole house. You have to give him the key. You have to give him the authority. You have to allow God to have control. Because when he's Lord, he can guide you. When he's Lord, he can protect you. When he's Lord, he can provide. He can safeguard you. When he's in control, he will open doors no man can shut. Come on. You've got to give him the door or the key to the door. That's why this year we are going to preach the gospel like never, right? We are going to share Jesus with our friends, right? We are going to go fill those empty spaces, right? We are going to go to the broken, to the lost, to the dying, to the poor, to the hopeless. And we are going to tell them about Jesus Christ. Come on, because he alone, I said he alone. And we better get it right. Jesus alone will satisfy the desire of your heart. There is nothing else that will.
God brings life to dead things. God can take any stuck situation and loosen it up. God can bring any dead dream and make it alive. Hallelujah. God is a specialist in this because that is what Jesus came to do. Faith is a substance of things hoped for. What are you hoping for? Are you hoping for your political party to win and change the country? It's not going to happen. God did not send a political party to save the country. He saved his son, Jesus Christ. So the political parties have to play their games. We have a mission to fulfill. The kingdom of God needs to be established. Amen. And God says that his kingdom shall be established upon each and every other kingdom.
Really invite your world. Invite your school friends. Invite the students. Invite your employees and your company. Everyone all across the Garden Route. This will be an incredible event where many people's lives will be touched and changed by the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is our time to do something incredible for Jesus. So I want to encourage you today, and I want to thank you for taking hands with us, to partner with us, to make this a huge success. We know that God has got a great plan for George and for the whole Garden Route, and we all have a part to play. So come on, family, Wednesday, 24 April, Harvest Event George. It's going to be one night to remember in Jesus' name.
The Lord of hosts, who is like Jesus Christ? Strong and mighty is our God, Lion of Judah rise.
Good morning, family, and welcome to our Sunday celebration service. If it is your first time with us, a special welcome to you.
Yes, Jamie, we are excited for today's service and can't wait to get started.
Amen, Shannon. So family, let's stand to our feet and join our band for praise and worship.
Good morning, CRC. Come to your feet and join us in praise and worship.
Thank you. to worship. Come bring your song. God's done great things, and he's not done. Let the sound of heaven come flood the earth. Let the saints rise up as your glory fills the church. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever.
Space. I can feel your spirit stirring. I've been praying, you've been working, working it all for good.
Yeah. gonna roll away the stone. Miracle after miracle. Miracle after miracle. Another one is on the way. Come on. He's the God of miracles. Miracles. Give him praise this morning. He's the God of miracles. Come on. Come on, lift up your praise. Your praise. Praise him this morning. Come on, close your eyes. Lift your hands and praise him. His name is Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Oh, come on, you are not here for me. You are here for him, and he is here for you. Because he loves you, because he's the God of miracles. Miracle after miracle, dead things will come alive in the name of Jesus Christ. If you believe it this morning, raise your hands and say hallelujah. 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 Miracle. Miracle. Another one is on the way. Miracle. Yes, come on, let's give him praise this morning. Oh yes, that's very important. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Amen. Welcome. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. What will separate us and what will differentiate us from the world? It's the presence of God. It's the praises of God's people that belongs to him. Praise belongs to God and God alone. Praise belongs to the name of Jesus, and I want to say that today. That is why you come to church, to praise God, to worship God. Amen. God dwells in the praises of his people. Hallelujah. God's got a great plan for you today. Amen. Welcome to church. Come on, let's give him praise. Say hello to somebody next to you. Come on. Give three people a high five. Tell them Jesus loves you. Welcome to church, everyone. Great to see so many of you here today. Thank you for coming to church. Come on, tell them Jesus loves you. I love your shoes. I like your hair, if you have any left. Welcome to church. Welcome to each and everyone today. Welcome to every first-time visitor. Come on, let's give them a hand. People that are visiting with us for the very first time, welcome to CRC, the place to be. We pray that God will touch you today and that you will truly be blessed. Amen. And then to each and everyone watching online, we welcome you. Come on, let's give them a hand. Thank you for joining online. We pray that God will touch you and bless you tonight, this morning, and tonight. And we know that there's no distance in the realm of the Spirit. God has got a great plan for you. If you are in George, come and visit us in the name of Jesus Christ. Are you glad to be in church? Yes, amen. Come on. You're welcome to take your seats today. So good to see you all here today. Thank you for coming to church. It's important to come to church. I was glad when they said, let us go to the house of the Lord. This past week, we were fortunate enough to be at the opening of the new CRC Kimberley building. And we thank God for that. A beautiful 3,000-seater building. Come on, let's give God praise. CRC. I thank God for the vision of CRC. I thank God for Pastor Art. Pastor Art is my pastor. Amen. And I thank God for the vision of CRC because it's an expansive vision. CRC is on a mission to take territory for God. Amen. Ons is nie net geroep om dieselfde groepie mense te wees elke liewe week nie. Kyk mekaar in die oë en sê, hoe gaan dit broer, geseend ek en jy. Nee, Jesus said the harvest is ready, the harvest is plentiful. So there are, you know, how many people are sitting here today? Let's say they're sitting 500 people. There's another 249,500 people outside of these walls that Jesus commanded us to go and reach. So we thank God for the vision of CLC. Incredible building. One day we're going to have our own building. Amen. In Jesus' name. We're going to have our own church building. Beautiful building for the glory of God. And then Harvest event is 10 days away. Come on, are you excited? Yes, come on, let's get up on our feet. The city will be shaken for the glory of God. Amen. Touched by the gospel of Jesus Christ, many people will be saved. And I want to thank each one of you. Thank you for already inviting your world. But I want to encourage you to continue to invite. At this stage, we're sitting around almost around 2,300 registrations, which is very good. But our goal is 5,000. Amen. So the purpose of the event is not just to come and listen to a great sermon from Pastor Art, even though it's going to be a great sermon, but we are inviting people so that people can be saved. Amen. We are hosting the Harvest event, CRC George, and it really is a seed that we are sowing into the city, a seed of souls. Amen. It really doesn't really benefit our church. It benefits the kingdom of God. So I want to encourage you also, we did not raise a pledge for that, but you would be wise to sow into it, because you are sowing into souls. What does it mean? What does Matthew 6 verse 33 mean? Seek first the kingdom of God. So I want to encourage you, business owners, it will be good if you sow into it, because it's the purpose of God in the city. It's a blessing to the city. Many people will be changed. Many seeds will be sown. So we thank God that we can host it. We are incredibly privileged, and we thank God for it. And we are excited to have Pastor Art with us. And remember, for us as a church, we are not really there to receive. We are here to serve. We are here to serve the city. Amen. So that night also, that evening, we are here to host the city. We'll be serving in every department. So thank you for each one that is involved. And thank you for inviting your staff and your family members. So it really is incredible to see the people's response, actually, when you invite them. Many people want to be part of something big. Say amen. Of Aula van Klein. Nee, jy mis ou nie van Klein nie. God did not die for you to live a small life. Do you believe that today? Can I hear an amen? Come on, say amen. The Bible says God so loved the world. The world. The world, the world, the world. Where there's no vision, people perish. God did not create you to be a chicken. God created you to be an eagle. God created you to overcome. God created you to dream big. God created you to do something special with your life. Do you believe that today? Is he the God of the living or the God of the dead? God came to break the curse of your family and raise you up to become the man and woman of God that he created you to be. Amen. Ja. Jy gaan nie, ons gaan nie toelaat dat godsdienst jou afdruk nie. Stilte kerk. Jy gaan die skok van jou lewe kry as jy die hemel maak. Regtig. They rest not day and night. Singing holy, holy, praises to God alone. The church should be a representation of heaven. Multicultural. Filled with life and liberty. Vryheid. So die gees gaan jou vry maak. Say amen vandag. So I'm very excited about today. The Bible says Ephesians 3:20, our scripture for this year. A year of overflow. How many of you are expectant for overflow in your life? Amen. Come on, raise your hand. Your expectation is God's invitation. Do you believe that today? You can say amen if you believe what I say, because it means so shall it be. The Bible says, be it unto you according to your faith. Whatever a man, what the Bible says, Jesus said, whatever you believe, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe it. So the whole purpose of the church is to preach faith into you so that you can believe. Amen. That's why it's important to come to church, because your faith levels are down low during the week, because you have to face life and challenges and setbacks and pay bills and you have to fire people and you have to now still be a child of God. Now you have to come to church and then your pastor is going to lift you up with faith. Amen. Because that's what faith does. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. Hallelujah. Faith comes by hearing the word. So it's important to be in church. Ephesians 3:20. Now to him who is able to carry out his purpose and do super abundantly more than all that we dare ask or think, infinitely beyond our greatest prayers, hopes, or dreams, according to his power that is at work within us. God can do far over and above that you can ask, dare, think, or imagine. The Bible says that no eye has seen, nor ear has heard, nor has entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those who love him. I don't know what you're facing today, but God can do far over and above that you can ask, dare, think, or imagine. Do you believe that today? John 10 verse 10, he says, the thief does not come except to steal, kill, and to destroy, but I, Jesus Christ, have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. God wants you to have a life that is full. Do you believe that? God wants you filled with joy. God wants you filled with life. God wants you filled with health. God wants you filled with peace. Do you believe that today? Or do you believe God wants you depressed? Do you believe God wants you to suffer and keep on suffering? What I say by that is there will be suffering. There will be trials and tribulations. But the Bible says in John 16:33, it says, there will be trials and tribulations, but I have overcome the world, says Jesus. When you are a Christian, you will face trials and tests, but you will have peace in the midst of it. You will have hope for a future. And that's what I want to encourage you today, because your life has a great purpose. The purpose of your life is to bring glory to God. And that's what I want to speak to you about today. For God's glory. Your life is for God's glory. Do you believe that? Everything we do is for life's glory. For God's glory. The darker the world, the brighter the church. Say amen. The brighter the church, the darker the world, the more your light must shine. You know, the Bible says in Isaiah 6 verse 1, this was a very difficult time for Israel, for Judah. The people lost perspective. The people lost hope. The people lost their purpose for God. And many people are there in the church. Many Christians, they are just going through the motions, but they're not really living for the glory of God. God wants glory in your life in every avenue. Do you believe that? Not just when you come to church. God is looking for a person that will bring his healing light and his glory into the world. Isaiah 6 verse 1 to 8, he says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above it stood seraphim. Each one had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one cried to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with his glory. And the posts of the door were shaken by the voice of him who cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. So I said, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a live coal, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth with it, and he said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your iniquity is taken away, and your sin is purged. Also, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Then I said, here am I. Send me. Hallelujah. You know, Isaiah had this incredible vision of God. And the moment he was in the presence of God, he fell down. And the angel came, took the coal of the altar, touched his mouth, took away, purged his sins. And that's what Jesus did on the cross. He purged your sins from your life. I want to tell you today that you are not a sinner. You are a saint. You are a son and a daughter of God. Yes, you might still be sinning, but that's a journey of sanctification. You are not living as a sinner because you're a born-again believer. Do you believe that today? If you have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, you belong to him. Jesus took away your sin, purged your sins. His blood took away your sins, never to be remembered. God is not remembering your sin. But the angel took the coal and touched his mouth, anointing him. The Bible says you have an anointing. You have been anointed. When you become a born-again Christian, the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for the Lord has anointed me. Jesus has anointed you. He has touched you, and he's asking you, whom shall I send? And this message is really a powerful message that every Christian has to answer continually. Continually, listen to me, because many people say yes to God. And what happens? Life throws curveballs. Life happens. People get busy. Unfortunate events happen. Tragedy, death, divorce, painful situations. And the yes they said to God now diminishes. The yes they said become a cold one. And the yes they said to God doesn't exist anymore. That's why you have to come to church so faith can be preached to you again. So your heart can become soft again. Because I want to tell you today that your life matters. Your life matters to God. Why? Because your life really is not about you, brother and sister. It's not just about attaining success. Your life is for the glory of Jesus Christ. Your life is for the glory of Jesus Christ. It's not so much the case that God has a mission for his church. God has a church for his mission. The mission was not for the church. The church was made for God's mission. God's mission is to bring the kingdom of God to the earth. God's mission is to spread the gospel, the flavor of God amongst the earth. Today we are living in an era where people are extremely self-seeking. People are extremely opinionated. God is looking for a person that will live for his glory. God called Abraham out of retirement. Amen. Was die mense wat reg is om af te tree? Moenie jou hand nou optel nie. God called Abraham out of retirement. He said, through you, the nations of the earth shall be blessed. Die Here kan jou roep terwyl jy wil aftree. Hy sê die Here, nee, kom tree aan, ou bal. Moenie aftree nie, tree aan. Dis tyd vir jou om te begin bid. Dis tyd vir jou om jong mense te begin oprig. Ja. God made Abraham's wife Sarah young again. Die Gees van God kan dit doen. Jy moet nie aftree nie, jy moet aantree. Don't plan to retire, plan to refire in Jesus' name. Do you believe that? God called Moses after 40 years and he brought him back to the fire through the burning bush. He gave him his purpose after 40 years in the wilderness. Very powerful passage also. Many of you will come back to your purpose today. God is looking for people that will represent him. God is looking for people that will bring him glory, because it really is all about Jesus. This is not about CRC. This is about Jesus Christ. CRC is a vehicle like every other church in the world that God uses to establish his kingdom. I want you to know that it's all about Jesus Christ. Everything we do is for the glory of Jesus Christ. Everything we do is so that another person can encounter Jesus and walk with him and represent him. God's glory is his honor, his majesty, his worthiness. God is looking for a person that can rest upon. The purpose of your life is to make Jesus famous. Do you believe that today? I want to encourage you today not to become shy, not to be a submarine Christian. You also don't have to be like me on the platform. I'm not always like this. This is when I'm coming, my grace and the anointing comes upon me. Maar jy hoef nie die pastoor te wees nie, maar asseblief tog sê net iets vir die Here. Ja, sê amen vandag. But then I also want to encourage you. You prove what you believe through your actions. Amen. Faith without works is dead. You don't have to be a talker, you can be a doer. You don't have to raise God, you don't have to praise God with your hands raised. It's okay. You're in a safe place. But praise God with your life. Praise God with your dedication. Praise God with your worship and honor. Praise God in how you love your spouse and your family. Amen. How you committed are to the kingdom of God. Praise God in that. I know people are wired differently, but that's what makes the church so incredible. Because we're a bunch of wild people together with a bunch of conservatives and a bunch of whites with a bunch of blacks. But that's how it should be, because that's what the kingdom of God is like. Oh, come on, man. Let's give him praise today. So the first thing you have to understand is God's glory is rooted and revealed in your relationship with Jesus Christ. This is not a religion, even though we call it a religion. Christianity is not a religion. Christianity is a person. Christianity is Jesus Christ. And your faith in Jesus Christ and relationship with Jesus Christ is what determines the glory of God. You have to be very intertwined with Him. The Bible says, John 15, verse 5 to 7, I am the vine, Jesus is speaking. You are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you cannot do anything. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. And if you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done to you. That's not me saying it. That is Jesus saying it to you. That's not a CRC doctrine. That's the Bible. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be given to you. Hallelujah. God desires to let His glory rest upon you. God desires that His blessing will be seen in your life. God desires that you have enough. God desires that you are made whole. God desires that your depression leave you. God desires that you have joy in your life. He says in verse 8, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so that you will be my disciples. It's very important, Christian, that your life bears fruit. Do you believe that today? Christianity is not just coming to church on a Sunday. Church is life. Church is what we do during the week and celebrate on a Sunday. Church is not just a building that I visit. Church is my life because I am a Christian. And you cannot separate the bride from the bridegroom. Because Jesus is the head of the church, therefore you cannot separate the head from the body. Therefore the body is always intact with one another. That's why my life has got a purpose. During the week I am together. Say amen. Okay. 2 Corinthians 3 verse 18, he says, but we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed in the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. If you abide in your relationship with God, what does this mean? Listen to me, Christian. Many a times you can fall into that trap and you become a religious Christian. You start to pray religiously. It's like a marriage. Everything works, but there's no connection. Did you get that? Everything works, there's nothing wrong, but there's no connection. Why did you even get married? Because you loved one another. Why did you become a Christian? Because you accepted His love. If you lose the connection, you lose everything. The glory of the Lord rests upon that connection. And I say that to everybody, every ministry in the church. That connection is the most important thing in your life. Why do you do what you do? To bring glory to God. Why do you serve? Why do you pray? Why do we do what we do? To bring glory to Jesus Christ. Jesus said, my burden is easy, my yoke is light. If ministry and serving the Lord has become difficult, you better get back to that place where the joy of the Lord is my strength. And how does that start? You become thankful for what God has done. You remember what He has done. You come to Him in prayer and just say, Father, thank you. Thank you that you have saved me. Oh, come on, Christian. He has saved you. Are you saved or not? Hallelujah. Get up on your feet and get in praise today. Come on, give Him praise if you have been saved. Come on, if you have been saved, give Him praise. If you lose that, you lose everything. This is not a religion of works. This is a relationship. The second thing you have to understand for God's glory is God has chosen you to glorify Him. Many people have become cold stones. Many people have become burnt out wood. Many people don't carry the fire of God anymore. I don't, it's not a matter of age. It's a state of your heart. People think because you are old now you can settle down in serving God. You're making a mistake. The kingdom of God needs you. The body is lacking without you. Jeremiah 1 verse 5, he says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were sanctified, before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet. What has God ordained you to do? John 15, 16, he says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain, and that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you. If you are connected with him through Jesus Christ, you can ask the Father anything and he will do it for you because he loves you. You might be a single mother or a business owner. You might be a sportsman, a policeman. You might sit here, you are divorced. You are down low. I want to tell you that God has chosen you. God has chosen you for a purpose on the earth. God has chosen you for a purpose in George. God has chosen to bring glory to his name through your life. Do you believe that today? Say amen. Come on. You have to glorify God in everything that you do. You have to glorify God in your school and your university. You have to glorify God in your business. The Bible says, Deuteronomy 8 verse 18, remember the Lord your God, for it is he that has given you the power to acquire wealth. Why did he give you the power? So that he might establish his covenant to bring his name glory. How do you glorify God in your business? Build a business with excellence. Build a business with integrity. Tell your staff about your testimony, what the Lord has done for you. Pray for your staff. Give people more jobs. Give people a vision in your business and tell them, this is what the Lord has done. This is why we built this business. This business is not about me. This business is for the glory of God. Can you say amen today? That's what the purpose of business is. The purpose of your business is to bring glory to God. Glorify God with your friends and your family. Take care of one another. When you are married, take care of your spouse. Honor one another. Love one another. Forgive one another as Christ has forgiven you. Share Jesus with your friends. How many of your friends will perish without the gospel because you are not inviting them? Because you are not sharing your testimony with them? Because you are not praying for them? Pray for your friends. Pray for your family. Say yes to Jesus in your world. Some people will never enter the kingdom unless you invite them. Some people will never come in unless you pray. The reason that you are sitting here today is not because of your works, because you have been saved by grace, brother and sister. Somebody prayed you in. Somebody prayed you in. Oh, come on, man. Are you glad about that today? Because somebody prayed, you are sitting here today. And I want to tell you, every Christian is called to pray. Every Christian is called to pray for his world. You have to pray for your boss, even if he's a demonic possessed man. Oh my goodness, the blood of Christ will set him free. Hallelujah. What does it mean to be the salt and the light? You don't run away where there's an opposition. You stand representing the King of Kings. You have to bring honor to God and glory to him. Glorify God in the church. Genesis 28, 17, he says, and he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? That's how I feel about this place. How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. Hallelujah. And this is the gate of heaven. I want to tell you, the church is still the gate of heaven. The church is still the dwelling place of God. It's not the building. It's the people in the building. Oh, come on, get up on your feet and give God praise. If you are happy to be in church today, give him praise today. You are not praising me. You are praising him. His name is Jesus Christ. The church is not the building. The church is not the building, but we need the building. The church is the people, and God dwells amongst the people. So people that are enemies of the church, God will deal with them, because you cannot separate the head from the body. We know that the church is not the building, just as much as a hospital is not the building. A hospital houses the doctors. The church houses the prisons. Hallelujah. Yes. And Jesus said, I will build my church. He did not say, I will build a foundation or I will build a charity. He said, I will build my church because that's what he died for. Hallelujah. It's very important. If you raise your voice against the church, you raise your voice against God himself. If you raise your voice against the leader of the church, you raise your voice against God himself. Christian, do not become like that. Do not be a gossiper. Do not criticize what God has chosen. It's very important this. That's why I will tell this until Jesus comes back. You'll be doing very smart if you stay away from social media. Geloof je dat of niet? Of hou je daarvan om je kop vol gemors te krijgen? So what I would suggest is that you read the Bible yourself. Encounter Jesus for yourself. Make up your mind for yourself. Love like Jesus did. Or do you just want to be another person? Oh, I don't know. I just want to criticize. Did you hear about this? Did you see what they say again about this? Did you see what the pastor wore today? I wonder how much his shoes is worth. What kind of watches he's wearing today? Wat se kar het die pastoor? Hy mag nie, nie. Hy wonder waar kry hy die geld vir dit? Hy smokkel met diamante, as jy wil weet. So you'll never be blessed or grow anywhere if you have that mind. Never, 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 never. Doubtful, critical. Amen. Jesus said you must become like a child. Kan jy soos 'n kind word? You have to let go of your opinion. Some of you, your opinions is your God. Yes, your opinion is your God. So don't let it happen to you in Jesus' name. Glorify Him in the church. Become committed to church. Live a life that glorifies God. Be involved in any way that you can. Make a difference in the church where you can. Bring your kids to kids' church. Parents. Nie maar my kind hy al hy wil nie. Wel wie is die paas in die huis jy of die kind? Nie maar ek hou nie. Man, wie is die baas? Nie my kinders is die baas. Okay, understand? If you need to, I also did it with my kids, and I go to kids just with them, and I sit there for the whole. But then you miss the service. Yeah. I really, this is a very sensitive topic, but I'm going to say it anyways. Some people are worshiping their children. They can't make a decision without inquiring the children. Your children are children and they don't belong to you. They belong to Him. You are just a steward. Stop worshiping your kids. Worship the Lord in spirit. Oh, come on, give Him praise. Hallelujah. Yes. Think about it. Your children are not yours. Now you say they are. They are not. Where did they come from? From God. You are the parents chosen by God to steward them. Because what if you don't believe the God of heaven, but your child does? He's going to heaven and you're not. That's why Jesus said, those who do the will of my Father is my family. So I want to encourage all the parents here. You have to go pray that prayer and give your children to God. Say, Father, I am sorry that I've taken them. I give them back. And I want to tell you, God will take care of them better than you can. God will protect them better than you can. Oh, come on, if you believe it, say amen today. Yes. Yes. The third thing about bringing God glory is, listen, your yes to God is a no to many things. To everything you say yes, it means you say no to something else. When you are a Christian, you cannot be a people pleaser. Do you believe that today? Matthew 5 verse 13, he says, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its taste, which is its purpose, how can it be made salty? It is no longer good for anything. Many Christians are there. But to be thrown out and walked on by people when the walkways are wet and slippery. You are the light of the world, the light of Christ. A city on a hill cannot be hidden, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand. And it gives light to all who are in the house. Now listen to this. Let your light shine before men and women in such a way that they may see your good deeds and moral excellence and recognize and honor and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Hallelujah. Jy is die sout van die aarde. Jy is die lig in die wêreld. So saying yes to Jesus means you're going to say no to many other things. Luke 9 verse 23 says the following, then he said to them all, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. I want to tell you today, if you lose your life for Christ, God will give you more. Say amen. Christianity is about surrender. Christianity is about giving over. Christianity is saying, not my will, but your will be done, Father. So sometimes a good thing is not a God thing. Sometimes saying yes to a good thing is not saying yes to God. Sometimes the very blessings that you have prayed for is taking you away from God. I want to tell you today that God is worthy whether you are blessed or not blessed. Jesus has to become your portion whether you have a lot or whether you have little. Paul says, I have learned to be content whether I'm lacking or whether I abound, because I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Whether you say yes to God, it means sometimes you say no to something else. Many people are in this state. They are Christians, but the very busyness of life takes them away from God. Their children activities, sports, and now what should I do, Pastor? My kids have church. Well, I'm here to tell you, seek first the kingdom of God. Not seek first your children. Seek first the kingdom of God. Because if you don't say yes, God will find another. Hallelujah. That's what people don't understand. God is not here to please you. You are here to serve Him. Sometimes the very good things, you pray for blessing, God blesses your business. The blessing of your business takes you away from God. You pray for children, you never have children. God blesses you with a child. Now the child keeps you out of church. God has blessed me. But what happened to your purpose? Yes, I know you're a mother and a father. Right? That's part of your purpose. But what has God called you to do? Good is the enemy of God. Great. Good is the enemy of great. Sometimes saying yes to God means you're going to say no to many other things that are good. Because God has something better in store for you. Amen. Some friends you're going to say no to. Sekere vriende kan jy nie meer saam kuier nie. Jy kan nou nie meer 3 bottles wyn op 'n Vrydag drink nie. Jy moet nou dalk net 3 glasies drink. Julle godsdienstige mense, is julle nog okay hierso vanoggend? It's okay to drink wine. Don't get drunk. That's what the Bible says. Yes, the Bible says. It's okay to have a glass of wine with your wife. Maybe you should have a glass of wine with your wife because you are so stiff. Jy het so styf geraak. Julle verhouding is sommer so styf. As julle mekaar druk en druk, julle mekaar ook so styf. 'N bietjie ontspan asseblief. Paulus het gesê vir Timoteus, drink 'n bietjie wyn vir jou maag. So I'm saying, don't get drunk, but whatever. The Bible says, use everything in moderation. In every aspect of your life. So some thoughts have to leave your life. Some thoughts you say yes to, other thoughts has to leave. Some actions you say yes to, other actions will leave. Because now I serve God, I say no to many other things. Even for me as a pastor, my weekends belong to God. I don't have a choice. It's what I said yes to. Saturdays, I dedicate to preparation. Sundays is church. And this is for my whole life. What about my family and children? Do you think about that? What I mean by that, I'm not asking you to feel sorry for me. I'm just saying. But sometimes you say yes to God when you say yes to a home cell. It's a sacrifice. Yes? When you say yes to prayer, it's a sacrifice. But the blessing and the fire comes to the sacrifice. Hallelujah. Without sacrifice, the kingdom cannot be established. The kingdom of God is built upon sacrifice. These beautiful ushers, some of them are here from 6:30 today. The band is here from 6:30 a.m. Why? To serve the people. And most people just come to church.
I don't like the music. Ek hou nie van die musiek nie. Wel, niemand het jou gevra nie. Ons sing nie vir jou nie. Ons sing vir hom.
Hallelujah. Ja, kom gee die Here prys. So some of your yeses to God, you must revisit. Some of you made commitments to God and you have not kept the commitments. It's time to revisit those yeses. Saying yes to God means saying no to negativity. Saying yes to God means you say no to depression, even though it's a real thing. But I choose to believe God's going to change me. God's going to lift me. God's going to get me out of the hole. Do you believe that today? He's a healer. Saying yes to God means saying no to being anxious. For the Bible says, be anxious not. Say no to fear. For God has not given you a spirit of fear, but one of power, love, and a sound mind. So where your focus goes, then your energy will flow. So keep your eyes on Jesus. Do you believe that today? And then quickly, the last thing. For God's glory to be on your life, you have to understand God will restore the glory to your life. You know, this is the beauty of the gospel, that God gives you beauty for ashes. And that's why I say, you must never forget what God has done for you. If you don't know what He has done for you, it's time that you get a revelation of what He did for you. Maybe you think, well, Pastor, I never really went off the rails, or ek het nooit grondpak geloop en baie gedrink en dwelms gebruik. Almal dink jy moet eers dit doen voor jy nou 'n ordentlike Christen kan wees. Nee. Your story is your story. But whether you drank 50 bottles of brandy a day or you drank nothing, you both were exactly the same sinners. For all have fallen short of the glory of God. For all have sinned. So every person is a sinner that needs to be saved by the grace of God. No matter how good you try to be. No matter how much money you give to the poor, if you are not saved, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Some people think they can go to heaven through good works. You cannot. I don't care. That's what Paul says. If I give everything to the poor, and I have not love. Nicodemus said, if you are not born again, how can I enter the kingdom? Jesus said, you must be born again. Can I try to be a good person? The rich young ruler, he said, Rabbi, what must I do to get into the kingdom of heaven? He said, obey the laws. He said, I did. Then Jesus spoke to him about the thing that was dear to his heart, the rich young ruler, and he said, go sell your possessions and give it to the poor. And the man could not. And he wept. That's what the Bible says. So God will restore the glory in your life. But you have to understand that you need Him. If you don't understand that, why do you need God? Because the very foundation of Christianity is our very dependence on Him. So God will restore the glory to your life. It doesn't matter where you've been, what you've done. God will restore glory. Maybe you're sitting here today, you are divorced. You went through a painful divorce. You had a painful past. Maybe you had abusive parents or an abusive partner, or something happened in your life of extreme pain and trauma. Maybe you were raised as a kid and you were brought up into the demonic and witchcraft. It was not your choice, But God will restore glory to your life. Maybe you were bound by religion your whole life. Your pa and ma nooit vir jou gesê hulle is lief vir jou. It wasn't your mistake, but God will restore joy, glory to your life. Do you believe that today? Because he's the lifter of your head. You'll restore it. Jeremiah 33 verse 6, he says, behold, I will bring it health and healing. I will heal them and reveal to them the abundance of peace and truth. God says to you today, abundance of peace and truth. Joel 2 verse 25, he says, then I will restore the years that was taken from you. I want to tell you, you might have lost 5, 10, 20 years. God can restore in 5 years what you lost in 20 years. Do you believe that today? Because God makes everything beautiful in his time. Isaiah 61 verse 7, he says, instead of your shame, you will have double honor. Instead of confusion, they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double. Everlasting joy shall be theirs. God wants your life to be filled with his glory. God wants you to represent him everywhere you go for his glory. God wants to heal and restore you. Why? For his glory. It is all about Jesus. It is all about Jesus. Jesus saved you for his glory. He saved you for his purpose. Don't get swayed by life and all the negativity, all the criticism, all the persecution. Don't look to that. Look to Jesus, the author and the perfecter of your faith. I want to pray for you today. I want you to close your eyes. Everywhere, believers, I want you to pray right now. Father, we thank you for your presence in this place. Lord, we thank you and know that you are God of heaven, but you are also our Father. Jesus, I thank you for what you did for us on the cross. Lord, and I pray today that people will receive you, that people will understand what you did for them, that they will know, Lord, they have a hope and a future, that you will restore glory to their life. Lord, that their hair will grow again like Samson. Father, whatever they have gone through, you know exactly, Jesus. You are the lifter of every head. You are the breaker of depression. You are the breaker of bondages. Father, in the name of Jesus, bring liberty, I pray today. Bring clarity and peace to situations, I pray. That people feel they're up against the wall, they have no way to go. You are the God of the impossible. You are Jehovah Jireh, our provider, Father. You are the one that makes a way where there seems to be no other way. And right now, we pray that over every situation. Father, every stubborn situation where people think it's impossible. Lord, let your glory come into every situation now in Jesus' mighty name. Every person that they are trusting you for, Holy Spirit, we ask you to go fetch them. We ask you to go speak to them in their midnight hour. Those who are crying out without even knowing, Lord, we ask you to visit them. I ask you to bring restoration to your people, Father, spirit, soul, and body, every area of their lives. Those who have been hurt, Lord, bring healing. Right now, bring healing. I just want you to take a moment. Let the Holy Spirit just touch you. Father, touch them, I pray, each and every person. Touch them, I pray, in the name of Jesus. We thank you for your presence. While every head is bowed, every eye is closed, today I want to ask you a question. If you have peace with God, do you have peace with him? As jy vandag moet sterf, weet jy of jy dat jy hemel toe sal gaan? As jy oortuig dat jy hemel toe sal gaan? It's a reality. Every person will die one day. The Bible says it's appointed for man to die and then the judgment. You do not have to face the judgment of God because Jesus faced it for you. Maybe you are sitting here today, you are hopeless. You have never given your life to Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And nobody comes to the Father but by me. I want to pray for you today. Miskien het jy nog nooit jou hart vir die Here gegee nie. Miskien is jy 'n goeie mens. Jy probeer 'n goeie mens wees. Jy gaan jou hele lewe lank kerk toe. Ek sê vandag om vir jou te sê, goeie werke gaan dit nie doen nie. Moenie laat godsdienst by jou steel nie. Jy kort 'n lewendige verhouding met God, jy moet bekeer. Jy moet jou hart vir Jesus gee. Jonk en oud. Jesus sê, ek staan by die deur van jou hart en ek klop. As jy oopmaak, sal ek inkom. God has got a great plan with your life. He's got a great destiny for you and he will bring restoration and glory. So right now, if you want me to pray for you, quickly and quietly, I just want you to raise your hand. Say, Pastor, pray for me this morning. Say, I want to make my life right with him. Thank you. Raise those hands. Thank you. Raise your hands. Thank you. Dankie. Kom, tel op julle hande. Tel op julle hande. Vandag is die dag. Today is the day of salvation. Raise your hands. Thank you. Thank you. Come on, Jesus loves you. Don't be shy. There's no shame. Thank you. Thank you. You have to be born again. Come on. Jy moet jou lewe regmaak met die Here. Jy weet nie of jy volgende week sien nie. You don't know if you will see next week. If you give your life to Jesus, you will have peace with God. Raise your hand quickly. Let me see. I'll give you another chance. Raise your hands. Raise your hands. Thank you. Dankie. Baie dankie. 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 Amen. Can I ask if we all stand today, family? Thank you. Quickly, let's all stand as we're going to close, almost close the service. Right now, I want to pray for you. Each and every person in this place, I want you to be very bold. You have nothing to fear. I want to pray for you right here at the altar. I want you to be very brave. Take your personal belongings. Come right here to the front because we're going to pray right here at the altar as you make right with Jesus today. Come on, let's clap our hands as they come. Come on, let's clap our hands.
Coming back to first. Coming back to
oh, come on, let's clap our hands.
Coming back.
Come on, clap your hands. Amen. Come on, let's clap our hands. Let's give God praise. Yes, amen. So we are very proud of you. Almal van julle wat hier voor staan. So there is no shame ever, you know, when you come to Christ. There's only glory. You receive His glory today. And thank you for being brave. Dankie dat julle die besluit neem vandag. Die Here gaan 'n nuwe ding doen in jou lewe. God's going to do a new thing in your life. Amen. Are you ready for that? Come on, I want you to put your hand on your heart. Come on, let's pray together with them. I want you to close your eyes. Just say this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, thank you for saving me. Today, I believe you're the Son of God. I accept what you did on the cross. I give you my life. I give you my heart. Use me, Lord, for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen, amen, on the profession of your faith, you are born again. Jy's wedergebore. Oh, come on, let's clap our hands, man. This is what it's about. Amen, so we want to pray for you very quickly. Can you just turn to my left? Just look at our ushers right there. We're going to pray for you very quickly. Just go with them. Thank you. You've got nothing to fear. Come on, let's give them a hand. Give them a hand. We honor what God did today. We honor what the Lord did today, bringing people to salvation. Yes, this is what it's about, family. Dit is waaroor dit gaan. Dit is waaroor dit gaan. Dis waaroor dit gaan, né? Amen. Come on, we praise God for salvation. We praise God for souls. Amen. Amen. Come on, you can take your seats as we look to the announcements.
Family, I think we can all agree that today's message has touched many lives.
Amen, Shannon. And family, can you believe it? We are already in the month of April. And do you know what that means? It is the month of harvest.
Yes, family. On the 24th of April, CRC George's harvest event will be taking place. So save the date, family. We are expectant for thousands in attendance and multitudes to get saved.
With only 10 days to go, family, we hope you are excited for CRC George Harvest Event. Let's take a look at a few easy steps to register for the event to ensure that you don't miss out on any details.
Hey Monique, have you heard that the biggest Christian event is coming to George on the 24th of April at 7 o'clock?
No, please tell me more.
So it's a free event. There will be Kids Church where you can go and drop your kids with our incredible Kids Church workers, and they can spend some time in praise and worship while the parents enjoy a fantastic word from Pastor Art Bosshoff. Let me show you how you can register. So if you go onto our website, you'll see that it says George Harvest 2024, and you can click on the register today and register yourself as an invite by giving us your name, your number, and we will contact you with updates for the event.
On young people, we are praying for a revival, but no revival is going to come through people that are lukewarm, afraid, apologetic. It's going to happen through people fueled by the Holy Ghost, people that will go to school and say, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel. I am anointed, I am appointed. I don't have a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. Shout it again, young people. Say, I am anointed for purpose. Say it in Jesus' name.
Well, family, we hope you are excited for this upcoming week.
Absolutely, Jamie. CRC is truly the best place to be. We are excited about our upcoming harvest event. And remember, everyone, invite your world.
Amen. So we are very excited about harvest events. As time goes by, like I say, 10 days, dan gaan die stad geskit word. So we thank God, amen, for this. Really is an incredible privilege. I want to say this also, you know, when it comes to altar call in the church, this is why we do what we do. Amen. When people come to Christ, this is the highlight of the service. And that's what I want you also to understand as a person being here. It should excite you when people come to Christ. Think about that. If that does not excite you, I don't know what will excite you. If you're a Christian, now you get excited about sophisticated things. Well, what's more sophisticated than salvation? What's more glorious than salvation? No, but you never know what happens through a single decision of a person that's at the altar. How many of your lives changed at the altar? Raise your hand quickly. My life also changed at the altar. So a single decision can go very, very far. Waar is die muziek? Laat my nou hier nie stil te bly. Okay. All right, so quickly for tithes and offerings. Ek kan nie in sulke stilte preek nie, asseblief. Dan moet daar 'n bietjie lewe wees. All right, for tithes and offerings. Luke 6 verse 38 says the following. Give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over will be put in your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. In Matthew 6 verse 24, you cannot serve God and riches. He says, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and he will love the other. Or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. All right, so Jesus spoke about this. Your money is an outflow of your life. Let your heart belong to God. Let your giving be easy. Let your giving be towards Jesus Christ. As we were driving to church today, I was asking the kids, because we had some friends, kids sleeping over at our house, and all five of them drove with me. And they asked me for money for tithes and offerings. Then I said, okay, well, do you know why you give? And they gave their reasons, so that we can build the church. And I'm saying, that's great. Yes, you've been taught well in kids' church. But the thing is, you give because you love God. That's why you give. You give because you love God. That's the main reason. Because I want you to think about this. As you give, God receives it. Meaning, you do not give unto to a man. You give to Jesus. The Bible even says Jesus receives our tithes. In Hebrews, you can go read it. So Jesus receives what you give. What you give, it's a spiritual thing that you bring to the Lord. So may God bless you as you give. Come on, I want to pray for you over your offering this morning. Give with a glad heart. Father, we thank you that we can give. Thank you that you're our provider, that you are our healer and our deliverer. Lord, we pray that you'll bless each one as they give according to your word. We pray that you'll bring breakthrough and provision. We thank you that we can build your house. We thank you that we can be expectant for the future. We thank you that we have a hope, Lord. Pray for your peace to be with each and every one. We praise you today in Jesus' name. If you believe it, you can say amen. Amen. The ushers can rise while we listen to an anointed item. The doors are just locked for security reasons. So please just, if you want to go to the toilet, just wait for 5 minutes. God bless you. See you tonight, family. 10 days to harvest event. So if you have people that you want to invite, miskien moet ons die mense in die ouer huise ook gaan nooi. Amen. So let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let every person has at least one chance to hear the gospel. Amen. God bless you. See you tonight.
Right here in the house. We love you, family. Have a blessed week.